Welcome to a recent interview that I shared with a local alternative care practitioner, Todd LeCesne, who I really think of as an absolute futurist. That is, someone that is taking full advantage of the synergistic potential of conventional healthcare and cannabis therapy. I hope you enjoy. Now, all that you mentioned has brought up perhaps the most important question that my students wanted me to ask you, which is, from your perspective, how do you go about trying to individualize or at least optimize the types of cannabis that you suggest for patients? So you mentioned that ultimately it's the patient's decision to experiment. And as we know, given the nature of cannabis, they must continuously experiment because ultimately it's really hard for them to obtain the same product twice.
Sure.
So they have to engage in this form of experimentation, which presents a problem domain that is quite complex because obviously, you know, you're working within a moving environment. We continuously need guidance from our providers. And the question, I guess, is how does a responsible provider that is essentially a specialist in this area start to learn about the patient's needs in ways that you start to tailor specific advice?
Mm-hmm. So it's difficult. And, you know, when you go to, I remember when I first started in clinical practice, with regards to initiating medication therapy. Let's use a class of medication like beta blockers, blood pressure medication. These things all terminate with the olol suffix, so atenolol, timolol, esmolol, these type of medications. And, you know, I remember thinking to myself, well, how am I gonna know everything about all those darn beta blocker medications? Not to mention there's ACE inhibitor class and calcium channel blockers, alpha blockers, all under title of antihypertensives. There's so many things to know about all those intricacies. So the way that you do that in pharmacology and Western medicine is you pick one, and you know everything that there is to know about that particular one. Okay. You start with what you know, kind of thing. In cannabis, I'm doing the same thing also. So currently, the buzz topic is cannabidiol. Cannabidiol is a very effective, non-intoxicating, anti-inflammatory medication that when combined with the other constituents in the plant, be it the terpenes that provide the scent profile of how that particular plant may or may not affect you physiologically, in addition to the flavonoids, which is the taste profile that also has an effect with regards to this particular strain of medication that you may or may not offer to the patient. In addition to cannabidiol, other cannabinoids such as cannabichromine or cannabigerol, these other cannabinoids affect patients differently as well. And to me, that's the same thing as five different beta blocker choices. Mm-hmm. So what I do to get started with the patient is I narrow it down to what I know, and I narrow it down to this particular molecule, if you will, and then maybe start to build from there slowly and adding things on only when we know what we effect we got with the initial molecule, if you will. I think about things like cough medicines and the multi-medication cough medicine, Tylenol cold and flu that has dextromethorphan and acetaminophen and guaifenesin and phenylephrine and other additives, 5, 6, 7 different additives to make Tylenol, cold and flu, multi-symptom, so-and-so thing. Mm-hmm. We don't advocate that patients start with that particular medication either, because if they have an adverse effect to that, we don't know which one to point the finger at.
Sure.
So it's kind of nice to just say, hey, you know, we're going to just use guaifenesin to see if we can't loosen chest mucus. Same thing with regards to how I would choose to initiate therapy on the cannabis side. We're going to use just a topical. We're going to, you know, limit to a drug class that has very limited bioavailability and a localized effect. We might use a tincture, the tincture that is super important because it's got a dropper on it that can meter the dose a drop at a time. Mm-hmm. And so forth. We wouldn't necessarily advocate for an edible as an initial starting medication because one of the problems with the edibles is the homogenization of the cannabis within whatever the edible happens to be. Mm-hmm. We all know that you can add a pinch of salt over here, and if you don't stir that into, you get that one little spoonful that's got all the salt. Holy smokes, this thing is salty as heck.
Sure.
You know, so same is true with regards to the manufacturers of cannabis trying to add cannabis to an edible mixture, it depends on the homogenization process and how they're able to distribute that evenly throughout a chocolate bar or through a gummy or through other cookies and lollipops and all these other things that we consider to be edibles. So there's a little dosing variability within the edible class of medications too. The inhaled medicines are invariably the most difficult. Mm-hmm. Length of draw, how far you're going to take that that inhalation down, how long you hold that inhalation in, what's the temperature that that device is heating that molecule up that's allowing the cannabinoids to be activated or not activated. The activation is related to a thing called decarboxylation, and this is removing a molecule that makes the medication now active and so forth. And there's a lot of science on that. Those vape devices and so forth don't have a temperature indicator on there, and the ones that do, it's fairly complicated. 1, 2, 3 presses for this temperature. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 presses for this temperature. Mm-hmm. The so those are other things that affect how much you might give. The cannabis community is moving in the way of meter dose inhalers now that can duplicate a dose every time. Huh. But the interesting thing about that is what was the initial biomass that was utilized to create that medication? We know that there's different things that affect the cycle of the plant based on how it's grown. Mm-hmm. So plants that are grown indoors have a whole lot better chances of lessening the environmental effects than plants are grown outdoors. Plants even have regional specificity with regards to how that plant grows in your geographic region. So an Afghani Kush that might be a strain that was initially developed in Afghanistan or whatever geologic zone that happens to be in, now we grow those things in California and Colorado and Oregon, in New Mexico I don't know exactly where we're growing those things. But it's a different plant than it is here than it was in its parent form over there. And so there's some variables that we can't account for on that side as well.
Sure.
So all these things make it difficult to reproduce that particular dose.
I can't say it any better. All these variables and the randomness of these variables are an absolute nightmare from a scientific perspective of trying to control what the hell's going on.
Yeah, and this is one of the things that gives such pause to my colleagues.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
You know, the thing about that beta blocker medication, when you go to the pharmacy and you get a Tylenol, you're getting a Tylenol. I will say this, it's not 100% on the pharmacology side and the Western medicine side either. Different manufacturers have been known to cut corners on production and adding less of the active ingredient. And certain manufacturers, you can't get this particular drug from that particular laboratory because they've been busted for additives and things like that, or poor scientific method. There's a lot of history that shows that even on the Western medicine side, we're not batting 100 with regards to every single dose of Tylenol that you take. So
even to mention the individuality of our microbiome,
absolutely,
which could have diurnal cycles as well as other types of bodily systems, which we don't take into consideration when assuming that there's a standardized dose that's appropriate across different size and shape people and so forth. Thank you for watching this part of our interview. We truly hope that it helps as many people as possible, including some of you practitioners out there that are still open-minded and want to be able to utilize as many tools and resources as possible to continue to enhance the well-being of your patients. If you appreciate the content that we're bringing you nearly every single day, please consider hitting the like and subscribe buttons or sharing these videos with your friends and family. Consider becoming a Patreon to this channel or even a donor to the University of New Mexico Medical Cannabis Research Fund, where we are working very hard conducting cutting-edge research every single day using all kinds of different types of research designs, working with humans, animals, large data sets. We do it all, and we're working really hard essentially to improve the well-being of our community. Through these efforts, collectively, together, we're starting to feel it. We're changing the world.